Tonight, the Member of Parliament for Castries Central was today hanged in effigy by some of her constituents as a demonstration of their dissatisfaction with her performance. Young leaders of the St. Mary's College mount a road safety campaign to apply the brakes on the 7 road deaths recorded so far for 2018. Japan donates 2 pieces of equipment to the Castries Comprehensive Secondary School and the CCJ to appoint a new president within the next 4 months. Good evening to you. Welcome to the Monday edition of the DBS News World. My name is Timothy Polior. The Member of Parliament for Castries Central was today hanged in effigy by some of her constituents as a demonstration of their dissatisfaction with her performance. Representations of the veteran politician, who is presently overseas, were spotted in the graveyard in George V Park, which is also known as the Gardens. The nation's external affairs minister was made the United Workers' Party candidate for the city seat about a fortnight before the June 2016 poll. Prior to this, Mr. Peterson Francis, who subsequently became the mayor of Castries, had been the endorsed candidate. He claimed to have bowed out from the challenge for personal reasons. DBS's Don Nicholas begins our news coverage.
Disgruntled residents say they are frustrated with what they perceive to be the failure on the part of their district representative, Sarah Flood Bobra. A number of the residents say they supported her during the election campaign. They say they have visited her office repeatedly in connection with community projects that she asked to submit. But according to them, the same people keep getting all the contracts while they remain out of work.
Take pictures of different legal work. That was since, well, a year ago.
Things that need to be done. Like,
yeah, she make us take our pictures. We have bought it in. We have bought the pictures in. Well, she never take no step for it. She never come and check us. We have to be going up and down in the office, and people telling us, you know, there, you know, all them things. So all them things.
Yeah, and the same set of people
getting contract
over.
And once the people like that getting contract from different places, the people that was working for her not getting nothing. That's how I see it.
One resident who chose to conceal her identity expressed the desire to see her district representative in person. She paid tribute to the mayor for the fine job that he is doing in the city and suggested that he should be the district representative.
She not representing us properly. So long you in power, you neglecting us, you sending other people like it's the mayor we vote for. We didn't vote for the mayor. Yes, it's true, the mayor is doing a very good and fantastic job. But we need to see Mrs. Flood. Mrs. Flood, we bury Stanley Felix for you. We cannot see you up to now. You're giving jobs to your friends alone. Yeah. What going on? We want to see you. The mayor is doing a very good job, so we're making way for the mayor. We're moving Sarah Flood, and we're making way for the mayor.
The residents are hoping for a change in the situation. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The recent spate of crashes and collisions on the nation's roads has driven some students to action. They are hoping that through an initiative, less of their peers and other people will be negatively impacted. So far for this year, St. Lucia has recorded 7 road deaths. Alex Buske reports.
The RBC SMC young leaders are seeking to reduce the spike in road accidents on our roads by visiting several schools, raising the awareness of road safety, with the hope that the students and other road users make this a priority. The young leaders have taken this initiative after mourning the loss of their own friends who have fallen victim to road accidents. School counselor at the St. Mary's College, Christelle Lee, says the RBC SMC young leaders have truly been affected by the rapid growing number of road accidents.
They spoke about it, and during their brainstorming, that was one of the major themes that came up, and they thought they were looking for ways at which they could address that. As young people, they are future drivers themselves. They're going to get there. They're all excited about driving. However, they're seeing that their friends, people they know, people who have left, we had people who just left St. Mary's College, and they were involved in accidents, who was injured and who persons who passed away. And the boys felt, you know, this, they had to speak out. They needed to speak out and say, you know what, we, every one of them, everybody, we can't wait for other people to make the road safe. Everyone has to take on the responsibility of making the road safe. And that's what they're addressing or trying to look at, how to make road safety everybody's priority.
We, the RBC SMC Young Leaders, we plan to reduce the amount of road fatalities by raising awareness, and we plan to bring this project further by going to a number of different schools. Since we are such a large group at St. Mary's, we plan to break up in different teams so we can cover more and we can maximize our time. The message that we plan to bring to the schools out there and everyone who is listening, we try to make road safety their priority.
On Monday morning, the RBC SMC Young Leaders commenced the road safety awareness drive by addressing the students of the Vidbutel Primary and Secondary Schools.
This morning we're here at Vidbutel Primary and we have started our sensitization drive where we're sensitizing students about road safety, the risk involving road safety, and how to be better road users. And so my students are on that school awareness drive, showing a video, and which is followed by a discussion of the video.
This week, the young leaders will visit the Carmen Rene, Castries Comprehensive, Dame Paulette Luizy, Marshall Combined, and the Babono Secondary Schools.
I think it's a very good initiative because we've had several instances where persons have lost their lives because of not practicing proper road safety measures. I hope it continues annually, and I hope whatever information that is given will be taken very seriously and to heart, because a lot of times the fatalities of the road incidents are young persons.
The boys plan to visit another 6 schools next week. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Bousquet.
Meanwhile, over the weekend, the St. Lucia Fire and Emergency Services responded to 83 ambulance calls and less than half a dozen fire calls.
Inclusive of those calls were 2 MVAs, one in Mikud and one in Denry. The MVA in Denry, 3 patients were taken to Denry Hospital for treatment. There were no serious injuries. In the case of Mikud, nobody was transported to hospital.
5 fire calls were also recorded, inclusive of 3 structural fires.
We had 1 house fire at Lakwa Mengo, where the house was extensively damaged. We also had a fire at Massey Stores at the waterfront, which was confined to a chiller. So nothing too serious occurred there. It was brought under control. We also had 1 fire at Ridge 4 in Denry. That is a house fire, okay, which was brought under control. Nothing serious.
The remaining 2 fires were of burning debris, which were brought under control. And just this morning, a goods vehicle capsized when the driver attempted to make a U-turn while approaching the Deriso Gap.
I was driving, I'm at Longbourn to Southbourn, and approaching the Deriso Gap. I spotted this green minivan, indicating left. And as I drive approaching him, like, slowly turn right into Deriso. In an effort to try to avoid hitting him, I smashed on my brakes, and as a result, the van flipped and ran into the side of the road. There was no personal injury, but the van has loaded of goods, and as you can see, I do not know the estimated value of what is damaged there right now. We are presently waiting on the wrecker, and upon which way I will be able to It was carelessness on the part of the minibus driver, because what he was trying to do was to try to do a 3-pointer. He realizing well, like, you know, he was empty, and he was trying to do a U-turn right in the junction there. And again, his lack of experience or or his flexibility in moving around. He was not able to complete the turn before me.
The incident occurred at about 11:15 a.m. Social transformation and fisheries officials are looking to a public-private sector partnership to solve the infestation of the sargassum seaweed. Here is Don Nicholas with more.
Not only is the sargassum seaweed posing a hazard to the health of nearby residents, it is also affecting the livelihood of the fisher folk. Authorities from the Social Transformation and Fisheries Departments say they cannot do it alone. There has to be a national response. As a result, they are looking to public-private sector partnership to solve the problem.
It has to start from the grassroots in the community and go all the way up. I think I'm very encouraged by the fact that we have persons both in the private sector and in the public sector willing to make a difference.
Ministry officials are working with community groups in an effort to control the problem, but they acknowledge that it will not go away all at once. It will most likely get worse before it gets better. In the short term, authorities are undertaking a massive cleanup to deal with the stench.
The long-term idea was to hand the responsibility into a kind of public-private partnership, right? And which we think is a more sustainable thing than the government continuously coming in and cleaning up with heavy equipment.
Officials are hoping that more persons will come on board to help tackle this problem. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The United Nations World Health Organization has launched new guidelines aimed at helping St. Lucia and other countries end the reign of the tobacco industry. WHO said the new guidelines, together with an accompanying publication, will help Caribbean and other governments do much more to implement regulations and address the exploitation of tobacco product regulations. The UN said the guide to tobacco product regulation, building laboratory testing capacity, provides practical and stepwise approaches to implementing tobacco testing relevant to a wide range of countries, particularly those with inadequate resources to establish testing facilities. The guide also provides regulators and policymakers with comprehensible information on how to test tobacco products, what products to test, and how to use testing data in a meaningful manner to support regulation, the UN said. It said the guidelines will also assist in the implementation of the World Health Organization Framework Convention on Tobacco Control, a global treaty combating the tobacco epidemic through strengthening tobacco product regulation capacity in World Health Organization member states. Still in the first segment of the broadcast, Street Vibes.
Hi, I'm Alex Buske, and you're watching Street Vibes. Last week, advocacy group Raise Your Voice St. Lucia held a march in commemoration of International Women's Day. What are your thoughts about that march?
Well, I think this is a march we should have every year.
Why?
Why? Because I think it was great.
The Women's March was not a march. It was politics march. Because if you say it's 11 people you're going to have, they had more than 11 people. And the color, I didn't like the color.
Well, I was at the march, and I was taken aback when I didn't see any placards. And I know people had concerns about the fact that it's a women's march. But everything that government has done so far has affected women negatively. You see, when you take out some vention, like a nice program, you took out money for the schools, you affect women in general. You understand what I'm saying? And everything they has done so far has affected women negatively. So they have no reason to say that it was a women's march. What are you going to march for? A sympathetic march with 25 women? What are you going to bring out the 25 women? What impact are you going to make with 25 women marching? You know? When you march, you either march for a cause, a worthy cause, or against suppression.
I learned about Women's International Day, supposed to be an issue where women have to talk about their affairs. But I saw the march turn into a political issue, which I'm not pleased about. Most of our women and whoever spoke on this day of International Women's Day They shamed me, actually. I was expecting to hear women's issue that affecting women, as such as the ladies that got killed, Trisha, and a lot of rapings and abuse of women, ladies that do not have husbands, people that not taking care of their children. I'm désolé, how the French saying it, about this match that took place.
Well, I think it's a good thing that they got together. You know what I mean? Togetherness is strength and so forth and so on, you know? But whatever it is like then, as you said, the slogan, the political intervention, well, that was some kind of thing. I guess politics took its upper feet or foot to high something at one time, you know? But it's a nice thing to see how the women get along these days, you know, more care for children, more parental togetherness and so on, you know.
We, the men, have to cherish them and uphold them and guide them in ways, because the women are them dressing naked and them things on the streets, which is not good. So the women have right will always cover up and keep a goddess with themselves. And the match could happen every month or every 2 other weeks, just for women to know the benefits within themselves and how, on what's the purpose on this face of the earth.
Well, there you have it. You've just been watching Street Vibes with me, Alex Buske, down here at the Aquarius Crossing, the intersection of Coral and St. Louis Street. With that, we'll take you back to our studio.
Thank you very much, Alex. You are watching St. Lucia's television and news leader and listening to us on Rhythm FM 95.5. We are also online and on the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. Still to come, A city secondary school receives equipment from Japan and a workshop to develop a communication strategy and an action plan gets underway here. Welcome back and thank you so much for staying with the DBS News World. The Castries Comprehensive Secondary School today became the recipient of a computerized machine for the learning institution's machine shop, along with a concrete mixer for its construction department. There is Don Nicholas with a report.
The Japan International Cooperation System has been working along with the Ministry of Education to identify school projects that require attention. To this end, the Castries Comprehensive Secondary School became the recipient of a computerized machine for the school's machine shop, along with a concrete mixer for the construction department.
We've been working on this project for a long time, so we have discussed with the Ministry of Education, the Department of Education, to determine the product to be procured, and thanks to the information provided by the Department of Education, we determine the technical aspect of the products they need, and we procure all the equipment that we just saw. And also we ask the supplier to provide the training services as well.
School officials were grateful for the donation. They say it will go a long way in helping the students to develop their technical skills.
Also, we are looking forward to using these pieces of machinery to incorporate it and to expand our offering, especially on an evening. This school prided itself a number of years ago as having that day-night school concept, where around 4 or 5 in the afternoon, another group of persons would come in here and do a number of different classes in a number of different areas. So we are looking forward to transitioning or going back to what this school was originally, where you had day classes and evening classes.
The handover ceremony took place at the Castries Comprehensive Secondary School. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Don also reports that sporting activities pitting parents against students are among the items on the agenda as the Castries Comprehensive Secondary School prepares to celebrate its 44th anniversary.
An ecumenical service followed by a fun-filled day of sporting activities have been organized as the Castries Comprehensive Secondary School gets set to celebrate its 44th anniversary. Parents, teachers, and students will engage each other in sporting events on that day. This begins on March 26.
44 years of the institution molding minds of St. Lucia. On the 26th of
March, we'll be having our ecumenical service and fun day where we treat our students, and we, after the treat, we're going to have a day of sports where we have parents challenging students, students challenging teachers, our corporate citizens joining in and challenging teachers and students. So it's going to be a day of fun on the 26th of March after the ecumenical service.
On March 27th, there will be a talent show
where the students of Cassius Comprehensive are going to showcase their talents to the wider community. Each form will be putting on 3 or 4 pieces where they showcase what our students of Cassius Comprehensive, the talent that we really have at Cassius Comprehensive Secondary School.
And then there will be an open day on March 28th to highlight the successes of the school. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The CARICOM Regional Organization for Standards and Quality, CROSS-Q, today commenced a 2-day workshop here with the hope of developing a communication strategy and action plan for a series of renewable energy projects.
This is through the R3E project. The initiative encompasses the Regional Energy Efficiency Building Code, minimum energy performance standards for buildings, and labeling standards.
We need to keep the necessary stakeholders engaged in both the public and private sector so that when we finish develop the Regional Energy Efficiency Building Code, that we can get the most buy-in and use for this project. The Energy Efficiency Building Code has to also be looked at in the context of what has recently happened in the Caribbean in terms of climate change and the whole thrust towards energy efficiency. We have a significant impact in terms of how our contribution to global warming is minimal, but we are the most vulnerable in terms of the impacts of climate change on our territories. And with the recent occurrences in Dominica and the Northern Caribbean last year, energy efficiency has a significant role in helping to, we need to do our part in bringing that building code into fruition so that we will play our necessary role in mitigating some of the effects of climate change.
At the culmination of the workshop, Mr. Emmanuel says, campaigns will be created to focus on high-level engagement and stakeholder buying for the Regional Efficiency Building Code and promotional activities for labeling schemes. Christine Nevis-Duncan, project coordinator of the CARICOM Climate Change Center, which is based in Belize, coordinates a project called Energy for the Sustainable Development in Caribbean Buildings. It is funded by the Global Environment Facility with the United Nations Environment Program as the executing agency.
Our project focuses on 5 countries: Antigua and Barbuda, Belize, Grenada, St. Lucia, and St. Vincent and the Grenadines. And this project is really aimed at reducing the amount of greenhouse gas emissions coming from our buildings. Buildings account for 30% of our energy right across the region. So if you think about your energy, 100% you're paying for energy. 30% of that powering our buildings. So we have a serious problem. Energy really is what we call the underbelly of climate change, because with all of these greenhouse gas emissions, it's coming from the burning of fossil fuel, petroleum products, that's putting all of this carbon in the area, in the air. And what it is doing, it is now causing all of these ferocious storms, causing all these frequent and more terrible weather that's coming, because you notice your rainfall is heavier. You have more rain coming in shorter periods of time. And then we have the mother of all, Dominica, where almost 95% of the buildings were destroyed. This is why this project is so important, because it actually addresses tighter building standards, tighter appliances. So we have appliances coming from various countries, and the standards are not up to par. People have them in their homes. You buy a fan, within 2 months you have to buy another fan. So we want to make sure that items coming into our country are suitable for our people and up to standards, because we deserve it.
$150,000 was granted to the CARICOM Regional Organization for Standards and Quality by the JEF Unit project to ensure the involvement of all CARICOM countries. The workshop, which ends on Tuesday, is being held at the Coco Resorts at Rodney Bay. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Buske.
An organization calling itself she.lc last Friday collaborated with the Department of Gender Relations along with the Women's Month National Committee to host a women's forum. It was held in the conference room of the Cultural Development Foundation. Discussions were focused on gender parity and sexual harassment, among other issues.
When you look at what is happening now in the world, I think right now, especially with the whole idea of Press for Progress and all the harassment going on, we feel that right now, and in recent years, there's been a trend developing in St. Lucia. We really need to take time right now to have the discussion at all levels, because we need a united front in terms of going forward. And she.lc, we are here to lend our support and our resources to Government of St. Lucia, to gender relations, as well as all the various women's organizations or groups that deal with these issues.
She.lc has utilized social media over the past 3 years to discuss matters affecting women.
On the part of the Department of Gender Relations, where we're concerned, we are interested in ensuring that everybody's voice gets heard with reference to what they think sexual harassment is, because what we have noticed in St. Lucia is that different people speak to different things when they're referring to sexual harassment, to the point where some people actually believe that's not a problem at all. And so it is our interest to ensure that we get a feel as to what the general public feels, so that we can now pitch our activities, pitch our programs to, you know, be in line with what the reality is, so that we can take us to where we need to be in terms of understanding and appreciation of, you know, the issues regarding sexual harassment in particular, and just general gender parity. See again what the people think, what do they think, and then find out, okay, so they're there, then what do we need to do to take them where we need them to be?
International Women's Day was observed last Thursday under the theme Press for Progress. The public is notified that in keeping with changes in international oil prices and government's application of the modified market pass-through petroleum pricing mechanism, the retail price of gasoline, unleaded, and diesel remains unchanged. The retail price for kerosene and LPG 20, 22, and 100-pound cylinders have been changed. The price changes took effect from today, March 12, 2018. Gasoline remains unchanged at $2.80 per liter or $12.75 per gallon. Diesel remains unchanged at $2.80 per liter or $12.75 per gallon. Kerosene increased from $1.79 to $1.81 per liter or $8.13 to $8.24 per gallon. The 20-pound cylinder increased from $32.22 to $33.28 per cylinder. The 22-pound cylinder increased from $35.72 to $36.88 per cylinder. The 100-pound cylinder increased from $201.24 to $211.84 per cylinder. The retail prices of fuel products will be next adjusted on Monday, April the 2nd, 2018. The CCJ to appoint a new president by July of this year. The details in just a moment. Welcome back to the broadcast. Prominent St. Vincent and the Grenadines jurist Justice Adrian Saunders will become the third person to head the Trinidad-based Caribbean Court of Justice, CCJ, that was established in 2001 to replace the London-based Privy Council as the region's final court. Outgoing CCJ President Sir Dennis Byron, who is due to leave office in July, made the announcement at the 10th annual CCJ International Law Moot Competition in Trinidad over the weekend. Earlier this month, Trinidad and Tobago Prime Minister Dr. Keith Rowley confirmed that the issue had been discussed at the CARICOM Intersessional Summit in Haiti and that the regional leaders had agreed to the nomination of Justice Saunders. Trinidad and Tobago jurist Michael de la Bastide was the first person to head the CCJ, which also functions as an international court interpreting the revised Treaty of Chagaramas that governs the 15-member regional integration movement, CARICOM. Six primary schools in the Babuno constituency recently took part in a poetry competition. Organizers say it was of a high standard. Don Nicholas has more.
The organizers say it was a historic poetry recital competition, which was part of the independence activities for 2018. Six primary schools in the Babuno constituency participated in the event. Officials say it was of a high standard. It gave students the opportunity to showcase their talents and will be conducted annually. They say it can be a source of inspiration for other students. Each school will be receiving a video of the presentation.
And then to just simply give the schools an opportunity, not just simply to do the ordinary, but the extraordinary thing. And then we were extremely elated with the turnout today, the performance of the students, and the high level in which they presented their poems. And I must tell you, the minister has agreed that this will not be a one-off activity, but then next year it will still be on the calendar. So we just want to commend the teachers, the principals, the parents for the hard work they did in getting the students prepared for this tournament, or if I should say this competition. We will continue to work hard.
The activity started with a church service. Organizers are now looking at other options to showcase the talent of the students, such as after-school programs, which will encompass public speaking and quiz competitions, among others.
What we did in Babuno this afternoon was part of our 49th year independence celebration. One of the activities that, as parliamentary representative, I organized with the support of the district education officer, Mr. Cyrus Sipal, and his staff members, where we had two major activities for our independence celebration. The first one was a church service, where all the primary school students assemble at the Babuno Roman Catholic Church, where we had a church service.
St. Lucia celebrated its 39th independence anniversary on February 22nd, 2018. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Sports is next when the DBS News World continues in just a moment. Time now for commentary. Here is your presenter.
Last Thursday, 8th March, International Women's Day, was marked by some in St. Lucia by a march. Or was it? What really was the purpose of that march? I expected that a march by women, particularly on International Women's Day, would have been concerned specifically with those issues that need special attention for the well-being of the women of St. Lucia and their children. Issues, for example, concerned with the woman's role in the development of our nation, the woman's co-responsibility for the nurturing of the children of our nation, healthcare and education for women and their children, succession rights for unmarried women and their children, domestic violence and its consequences. But apparently, there was much more on the agenda. And for me, this begs the question. Did the woman who organized the march once again enable a man, one man, or some men to manipulate them and in so doing hijack their efforts? I confess I did not attend the event, but the videos and photos which I saw after the fact seemed to be more of a political march. I accept that maybe the person who took those videos and photos that I saw may not have been concerned with the plight of women and therefore ignored the placards or chants regarding those issues, and instead concentrated on the politics of the moment. But I'm of the opinion that the politics ought not to have been part of this effort at all. Besides, the politicians whom I saw parading in the march have done nothing when they had a chance to do so to address the issues which I raised earlier. And therefore, they are in no position to complain about what is not being done by those who now have the chance to make life easier for the women and children of this nation. In the videos that I saw, I heard nothing said to the women of Fair Helen that would encourage those who are totally dependent on their male partners for sustenance to take responsibility for their lives. Nor was anything said to encourage those who have managed to remain independent that they not give in to the pressures of society, which dictate that we must give it all up for love and marriage. I did not hear those words of encouragement, if at all they were uttered. And I am not here saying that women ought not to seek out love and marriage. By all means, do so. Some will find perfect partners and have loving relationships. Many will not. In either case, women must know that throughout these relationships, they should not give up responsibility for their individual well-being and the well-being of their children. I've been told that because I have never been married and I have no children, that I could not possibly understand the constraints that women face. You are right. It makes no sense to me. I really do not understand how intelligent women, many of whom are professionals with full-time, well-paying jobs, continue to suffer the injustices dealt out to women by men, who in this enlightened age continue to manipulate women. And I did not hear a demand to put an end to violence against women, many of whom remain in relationships where they are battered, sexually abused, and psychologically injured by persons with whom they should be enjoying the closest trust in a home where they ought to coexist in security and harmony. Women stay not because of blind love or because they truly believe the part about till death do us part. They stay because they succumb to society's pressure that to be without a man is to be deficient. Many stay, according to them, for the children's sakes. But often, it is because they are afraid of taking personal responsibility for their lives. Studies have shown that domestic violence often starts out with what appears to be trivial conduct, which very often escalates both in intensity and frequency of occurrence. At a sophisticated level, the violence may be psychological or mental, including constant verbal abuse, harassment, excessive possessiveness, and depriving the woman of economic, physical, and personal resources. It may also include destruction of her personal property, and the woman may be degraded and belittled, either alone or in the presence of others. We all know that there are many such households. Too many women accept this behavior by men and make excuses for it. Even at the very end, when the last straw has already broken the camel's back, when the victims have finally mustered up the courage to visit a lawyer to figure a way out, even then, they continue to make excuses. Ladies, if your man abuses you in any way, it doesn't matter how much he says he loves you or how well he takes care of you financially, he needs psychological help. Some men are sadists. They get a perverse pleasure in inflicting pain, whether physical or emotional. So get help, which really ought to be a free service offered by our healthcare system. After all, mentally healthy and happy men and women will nurture mentally healthy and happy children, which in turn will make for a mentally healthy and happy nation. And the place to address this is certainly not at a political march. For commentary, I am Lorraine Deborah Glass.
And now, the usual reminder. The Member of Parliament for Castries Central was today hanged in effigy by some of her constituents as a demonstration of their dissatisfaction with her performance. Young leaders of the St. Mary's College mount a road safety campaign to apply the brakes on the 7 road deaths recorded so far for 2018. Japan donates 2 pieces of equipment to the Castries Comprehensive Secondary School and a CCJ to appoint a new president within the next 4 months. And as the DBS News World, thank you so much for watching and listening to the broadcast. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Timothy Paul Leon, wishing you a very good evening. Goodbye.